Today we are going to have some idea about meditation. It is not directly related to our subject, but anyhow, as a basic one, it is also necessary. But in Tamil, some book is known as Dhyanam. If you have the book, you can refer all those things in that book. But if you don't, but there is no translation in English. So, not knowing the person who is not knowing Tamil, they have to take some notes. Otherwise, they cannot refer. There are three kinds of meditation. There are numerous kind of meditation, but the three kind of meditation which I have followed in my own life. So, it is a practical application with related to the meditation in three type of meditation, which my personally I have done for myself. I verified the validity of the three meditation. The first one is Sarva Rupa Dhyana or multi-dimensional meditation. Multi-dimensional meditation or Sarva Rupa Dhyana, that is the first one. The second one is Nirviharpa Dhyanam. Nirviharpa Dhyanam or non-dual meditation. Non-dual meditation. Non-dual meditation or Nirviharpa Dhyanam. The third one is Viharpa Dhyanam or dual meditation. Dual meditation. Non-dual, dual. Non-dual meditation is the second one. The dual meditation is the third one. Now we are going to describe what is the first one. The Sarva Rupa Dhyanam. Sarva Rupa Dhyana means, or multidimensional meditation means, observing everything totally. Not in particular, observing everything totally. For example, we are looking through our eyes. We are focusing our attention upon a single object. Some tree is there. We are looking at the tree with the help of our eyes. So if we focus our attention upon a single point of object, that is a kind of concentration. But if you, instead of that, you can have a total view of everything. Whatever you can see through your eyes, you can, as a blunt seeing, you can totally see everything. So that is the way you have to have, you have to use your eyes, you have to use your vision in a blunt way, everything totally. So that is the one aspect of this meditation. And the second one is, for example, I am talking and you can listen, you can hear the sound of my voice. At the same time, there are many sounds. Not only my sound, there are many sounds. So, if you listen, if you watch, if you attend my sound alone, it is a concentration. But if you attend all the sounds, including my sound, total sound, that is the another aspect of this meditation. So, here, looking everything totally through our eyes, hearing everything through the ears totally, that is the second aspect. And the third aspect of this if I touch this, I can feel the touch feeling of this. We can touch, we can have the touch feeling with the use of the my finger. But at the same time, our total entire body is having the capacity of touch feeling. So if you feel anything in particular, that's a kind of concentration. But if you feel everything throughout your whole body, that is not concentration, that is, it's a total attention. Some total attention through your body is the other aspect of this meditation. So in this way, you are having, for example, you are having a thought of somebody, of some of someone of your friend. You have a thought of your friend. So you know something about your friend through the help of your mind. But if you have the idea of your mind, of your friend through the help of your mind, so some concentration is there. With the help of the concentrated form of mind, you have an idea of your friend. But at the same time, if you don't have any particular idea, but instead of that, just as you use the eyes in total, you can use the hearing process as a total and use your body as a total. In this way, you can use your mind in total, not focusing upon a particular point. So that is the another aspect of this meditation. So in this way, we are having five senses, and including the mind, we are having six senses. So we have to wide open all the six senses, and we are attentive totally, not in particular. But this kind of, if you wide open all the six senses, that is the kind of, that is a multi-dimensional attention and multi-dimensional meditation. You have no single dimension, you are multi-dimensional. But here, there is no focusing point. So you wide open all the six senses. So in that condition, if you have any, for example, in a comfortable place, if we have a walking, but the place for walking must be in a protected one or a safe one. But it, sometimes you may be walking along a traffic, but at that time you cannot do like that. You cannot use this meditation. But in a beach or anything, or in a garden or in a park where there is no problem of traffic or anything, in that you can safely, you can slowly walk. And through walking, you can apply this meditation. And once it happened to my case, I usually have the meditation always. And once I walked upon it is a village, rarely some vehicle will come in the road. So I was on the meditation on my walk upon the road. But unexpectedly, some bus was coming in front of me. So I do not have an idea whether I have to move away from the bus or the bus has to move away from us. So I quite confused. Because when we are in the meditation, the total world will be one. So you cannot separate yourself from the world. But everything will be one. So if you slowly meditation, you will feel something like this. So in this way, if you are walking in a traffic road, it will be very difficult for you to act accordingly. But if it is in the safer side, if there is no problem of traffic and the path is somewhat in the, just like in the garden or just like in the mountain, and there is no traffic, there is no problem of moving or giving way to somebody else, something else. So in that you can safely you can practice meditation like this. And here the importance is that there should not be any concentration in any form. That is the main thing. Everything must be wide open. Your mind must be wide open, your ear must be wide open, in the all sensory organs, all sensation must be wide open, there should not be any focusing point. So you have to remove the focusing point, that is very important, and will be wide open. And if you practice this thing for some, and in course of time, you can be always in this kind of meditation from morning till night, till go to sleep, you can be in this meditation. With the, even you are in the meditation during your work, along with the meditation, you can work your work also. You can have some concentration also in your particular form. For example, if you are attending your work, official work, you have to focus your attention there. So when you come across, when you master with the meditation kind of meditation in daily walk of life, then you can establish a capacity. Even with the help of meditation itself, you can have some concentration itself. But actually, the meditation does not have any connection with concentration. But anyhow, with the help, even you are doing the meditation, in that time also, you can attend your work also. But in course of time, it will take. It will not be like that. In the course of time, it will be like that. But the very beginning, you should not try. But the very beginning, you have to establish this meditation as a natural one. Then only you can attend your. Then you can attend your work also. Apart from this meditation, you can work. You can go through your work also. And this is the first type of meditation. And in this meditation technique, because I have done this meditation for several long years back, so when I want to talk this meditation today morning alone, I read the book and I reproduced it, everything. But I mostly I might have forgotten. So if any feel any doubt, any clarification on this first meditation, and you can ask and you can get clarification. And moreover, whenever you do some practice, then only you can have some doubt, how some problem you may face. And in the evening talk, we may some clarification, we may have some clarification. But presently, if you feel any doubt, you can have. And we can clarify, and afterwards we can go to the next kind of meditation. But in that case, you are in a sleeping mode. But here, it is a waking mode. It is not sleeping mode. Even though you are not attending anything, you are totally vibrant, totally aware of everything. There is no. You can feel anything. So this is not like that. choiceless awareness.
And do we also, for example, when we are sitting and if we stand up, whatever is happening, the mind takes it.
No, there should not be any attention. There should not be any focused attention. Some wide opening, in opening itself some has got some kind of attention, but there should not be any focusing point of attention. But in the olden days, you might have seen a torchlight. The torchlight and the focusing point will be there. If you switch on the torch, the light will be focused upon a particular point. So if you remove the head of the torchlight, the bulb alone will be there. There will not be any focusing point. The focus in the bulb will have the light out throughout the place. But if you put the head again, and the focusing point will be there. The focusing will be in a particular point, limited point. But here, our attention must be total. There should not be any focusing point. But in the three cases, there is no place for closing your eyes. I am, the three meditation will be like that, open, in the open eyes. So whenever you practice the meditation, then only you can feel some doubt. So you can, whenever you have the time to apply this meditation, you can verify whether it is convenient or not. You can feel, then only you can register the doubt, and afterwards you can ask. And now we go to the second type of meditation, that is nirviharpa dhyanam or non-dual meditation. And this is very powerful meditation. you have to practice very lightly. If you very seriously practice this meditation, it will give you many powers, many things. And it is a powerful meditation. And this means you have to focus your attention upon the eye consciousness. Because we feel I am. Each and every moment we feel the sensation of I am, the eye consciousness. So you have to attend the eye consciousness. Whatever you are doing, your concern must be in the eye consciousness. Your attention, attention of your mind must be upon the eye consciousness. After having your basic structure in the eye consciousness, you can do other work. For example, whenever you have to travel in a crowded train or bus, you hold a grip in the hand and standing there. So in this way, one part of your mind must always have a grip upon the eye consciousness. So sometimes you don't have any other work, then you can, total grip must be upon the eye consciousness. Whenever you have some work in the externally, you can do all work, and one part of your mind alone has the grip upon the eye consciousness. But whenever you don't have any work and you are simply sitting, and if you want to close your eyes, you can close. But if you want to wide open your eyes, it doesn't matter. Whether you are closing your eyes or not doesn't matter. But your concentration, your attention must be upon the eye consciousness.
Eye consciousness, you mean
I am. The feeling of I am. So here, important things we have to understand in this meditation is that you have to give more and more importance to the eye consciousness. That is very important. And not only focusing attention, giving more and more importance to the eye consciousness is very important. And one is that you have to take note. You have to take the eye consciousness as your ultimate goal of your life. So whenever you are focusing your attention upon the eye consciousness, you have to think that you are focusing upon your ultimate goal, then only the concentration will form. Otherwise, some distraction will be there. Open eyes. You can open or you can close. Either thing you can follow. Sometimes you may sit in a sitting position. You may do this meditation. If you are in the sitting position, you can do this meditation with the closed eyes. But it is not.
So which part of mind, like yesterday we discussed, like there are four parts of mind. So which part of mind concentrates on eye consciousness?
So you need not confuse. Whatever you feel, this is the mind. With the help of this mind, you can attend. You need not select, you need not confuse which part you have to take, which part you have to be focused. You need not, whatever you, superficially what you feel, that with the help of the superficial mind, you can act. And you need not focus your attention, where is the part, where is the actual part of the eye consciousness. You need not search for your eye consciousness, whether here it is very deeper of your mind, whether deeper of your heart, you need not worry about that. What is superficially known as I am, that I am is enough. Upon the superficial I am you can focus your attention. But at the same time, that I am must be considered as the supreme goal for yourself. And the another one is that the I must be considered as the God himself. It is God itself. You have to give more weight, more important to that thing. Not an ordinary eye consciousness, it is the absolute God itself. Moreover, each and everybody is having the eye consciousness. Everybody feel I am, and you are also feeling I am, and you have to take that all I am is one. There is no difference between the I am of the other person and the I am of myself. So every I am is one. Even though the body is separate, the living is separate, the I am is one. And when you look at the I am, you have to feel you are looking at everybody. So if you give more weight to the I am, then only the focus will be easy. Otherwise, some dissipation will be there. And we may have many problems in your life. Many activities in your life. And if you have to come to a conclusion that if you look at the eye consciousness, all your problem will be solved. You have to come to a conclusion like this. So, if you give importance to the eye consciousness, focusing your attention to the thing, it is also focusing your work also, because you have to think like that, because you may have work, but you think if you focusing your attention there, it will affect the other work. If you think like that, then some distraction will be there. So focusing your attention there, it will help in all your work in a better manner. You have to think like that. You have to take like that. it will be helpful to all of your work. So if you took like that, your attention will be natural and spontaneous, because you put a background for your attention. If you do not put this kind of background for this attention, you can easily slip away from the attention, from the eye consciousness. Your attention will be slipped away. Other, if you put the like this, you make a fence and you can protect your attention. And in this attention, if your morning and evening or throughout his life, at any time you can have the attention. And if you go along with this attention, slowly you can feel some vibration of eye consciousness. That is the first symptom that you can feel. That's the eye consciousness begin to vibrate for itself. That is the first symptom. And in course of time, the second symptom you can feel, the total body become vibrant. The kuchamgra kenna English? Sensitive. Kucham. Sensitive. And you can feel some sensitive throughout your body. Sensitivity. You feel some sensitivity throughout the body. That is the second symptom of this meditation. And the third symptom of the meditation is that you will feel some bliss consciousness from yourself. That is the third symptom. But it comes one by one. First, this sensitivity of the eye consciousness, and afterwards the bodily sensation, and then the third one is the bliss consciousness. In this way it will come like that. And whenever you are focusing your attention upon the eye consciousness, the velocity of the velocity and the intensity of the bliss consciousness will go higher and higher. But in my cases, in my own case, I gone up to the level of the bliss consciousness, and somebody got some occult power and many other products like this, but I don't have any kind of things, because I am not interested upon this occult power and other things. It has not happened to me. But if you are interested, that occult power also is possible, and some special kind of energy is also possible. Only this meditation.
What kind of power?
Occult power. You can the Amanush, the third eye may open. you can have the vision of many things. Amanushyam. But it will create many problems for the regular spiritual life. So it is better to strict ourselves within these three kind of experiences. And the third one is the non-dual meditation. The dual meditation. Viharpa Dhyanam. That means, because we are facing many problems in the daily walk of life. For example, you have to live along with your enemy. So you are not one, you are separate. In all respect, you are separate. But you have to live, you are living in a hostel or anybody, anything. How to live? So how to manage with the life, manage with the thing, manage with the circumstances, in your office, in your anything. There may be, so there are many problems like this. I am not telling about husband and wife. They are very intimate, they are very close. There is no problem. But in the other cases, we can say like this. But how we have to take the other person, how to move along with the situation. That is the dual meditation. And this will help throughout your life. This meditation will be helpful throughout your life. For this, you have to take some other kind of practice here. And you have to select a park or some seashore, and you have to sit alone without any disturbance. And in front of you, there must be a tree or anything, just like tree. And the tree must be swinging in the air, so it must be somewhat swinging. And or in the seashore, you can watch the waves of the sea. Some movement must be there. Without motion, it will not be helpful for this meditation. Some object with some motion must be there. So you have to watch the moving tree, the swinging tree, wholeheartedly, without any disturbance, without any interaction. You have to silently watch the tree. And in this, after this session, we are going to discuss the Manolaya and Manonasa. That is a different topic. But here, we are applying the Manolaya. Manolaya means the mind is taking shape. The mind, when the mind is taking shape, it is known as Manolaya, or the formation of mind. For example, when look at any object, the light is there. We may look at many things. But whenever we focus our attention upon something and recognize it is a light, what is the meaning of that is that our mind is taking the shape of the light itself. When I am hearing the teaching of somebody, our mind has to take the shape of the teaching itself. Then only you can understand something. If the mind is not taking any shape upon the teaching or the word, we cannot understand anything. So if you want to recognize or understanding anything, the mind has to take the shape of that. For example, whenever we are going on the walking, we see a snake. And the mind takes the shape of the snake, then only we understand it is a snake. So whatever we understand, that means our mind has taken the shape of something. So when our mind takes the shape of something, then alone, it means we are understanding something, we recognize something. So in this way, when we attend a moving tree or the moving water as the waves of the sea, thereby we are observing the tree or observing the waves with all its motion. And our, we observe the tree or everything, thereby we are freely allow our mind to take the shape of the mind, take of the tree or the waves. We freely allow our mind to take the shape of the waves or the tree. Thereby, if you watch for some times, and you slowly become the tree itself. Sometimes some connection will be happen within 5 minutes, 3 or 5 minutes, you can have a communion with the tree or the sea. You begin to find yourself, you become the tree itself, and you yourself is swinging upon the air. The you yourself is flowing like a ocean with waves. That will happen within 5 minutes. So this is the practice for this dual meditation. And if you succeed upon this meditation, you can apply this same formula in each and every person. For example, you are looking at a cinema, and in the cinema two persons are villains, or that is not good person, they are villainic characters. We don't have any favorable attention, favorable thought about any of the person. Two persons, they both are villains. They both are unwanted persons of the cinema character. They are fighting with each other. Naturally, we don't have any moral support, or so we don't have any favor upon any of the person. We simply watch. They fight with each other. We look at it as an ordinary thing, because we don't have any favor upon anybody. Two villains are fighting, and we are watching as an ordinary thing or unwanted thing, unnecessary thing. And another instance of the same cinema, the villain and the hero of the cinema are fighting. And the hero is beating the villain. Now we have, but our favor, our attention, our concern must be towards the hero, not towards the villain. So it may be a favorable one. We look as if we ourselves has beating the villain itself, and we can have the feeling as a good feeling that we can beat the, we ourselves can beat the villain. We can very easily watch the thing. That is the second scene. The third scene is that the hero is a weak person and the villain is a powerful person. And the villain is beating the hero. Now we are watching the scene. How we are watching? Because our favor must be towards the hero. And if he got injury, we think we ourselves has got injury. We will have the concern like this. But if you watch the scene with this kind of meditation, you have to be attentive with the action of the villain as well as the action of the hero also. So when you watch this scene with this kind of the dual meditation, you yourself beating the hero as the villain itself, and you yourself getting the injury as the hero gods. So you yourself become the hero, you yourself become the villain itself. So you become one with the object. So this is the dual meditation. And then this, in this way, you can apply all those this technique in each and every part of your life. There are many things. Sometimes you are, if you are in a working in a office, your boss may be a villain. All bosses are villain. So you have to become the villain himself. Then only you can be free. You can be free with the help of this meditation. And afterwards, the another aspect of this meditation is that so, for example, we may have some good feeling or bad feeling within ourselves. So, we have to be one with the emotion. So, whether it may be a good feeling or bad feeling, anger, fear, sorrow, whatever may be. If you are attentive, in the just as a dual meditation, you have to be one with that. There is no selection. This must be like that. This must not be like that. That you become the fear itself. You become the anger itself. You become the worry itself. So, when you observe like this, you become the emotion itself. So that is the dual meditation, with related to your emotions. And these are the three kind of meditation. And the third one is, throughout our life you can follow this. And it will be peaceful. If the situation may be in an adverse type, you can be peaceful. But the first one is beneficial. There may be certain person, they may not have some sleep in the night. It will be good for the sleepless persons for the first meditation, and if you have any problem in health problem also, it will be helpful to get away from the health problem. And the second one is, it is a powerful meditation, and you have to go into the meditation with some precautions, because it is not go beyond the limit. Within the limit you can practice. If you go beyond the practice limit, it may creates many problem also. So within a limit it will be good. And the third one is always helpful. Throughout your life you can follow. And you try this meditation, these three meditations, and you can ask any question afterwards if you feel any doubt in that question. Now itself you can have asked question. But after practicing the meditation in your life, then afterwards also you can ask question in the evening session.
So in this third meditation, there are so many things I can watch and identify like this. You said the tree and the sea and the villain and the hero and my boss, anything. So if I'm going to start practice this, how do I choose what is a good thing to connect with like that?
So here, so you have to identify, as a meditation alone, you have to follow like this. But at the same time, you have to, in action, but you should not, for example, if some thief snatched away your property, you should not allow him to snatch away. You should not apply the dual meditation and watch and enjoying the running away of the thief. You should not enjoy the like this. You have to act. But as a meditation alone, you can use meditation. Somebody, because you have to live along with the, all the persons will not be good. Some person may be wrong, some person may be aggressive. So in that time, you have to safeguard yourself. Psychologically, you have to be all right only because of this meditation. And for that, to say, for the psychological equilibrium, you can use this meditation. But it is not useful for the physical work. Physically, you have to select, you have to discriminate hero and villain. You have to behave carefully with the villain, and you have to, unnecessary person, you have to behave carefully.
Yes, I understand I have to live normally, but my question is, what kind of things is good to make this connection with? I mean, I can make connection with anything, a tree, an ice cream, a glass of water, or the sky, or the sun, or moon landing, so many things. So how do I know what will be good to do this practice with? This is my question.
So psychologically, you have to make yourself in a good state. So for making yourself in a good state of mind, you can apply this meditation. But for the external activities, the meditation, some way or other, you can, in a different manner, you can function. For that, it also helpful. But you have to be use your intellect, how to behave in the circumstances, that you have to use your mind. That is not meditation. That you have to apply your mind, in what way you have to behave, what you have, what process you have to take, that you have to be careful. But psychologically, you have to keep yourself in an equilibrium. For that, this kind of meditation is useful. Have I replied properly?
Selection of the object on which I should focus on. How to select where to focus on? Like.
So first of all, you have to observe some moving tree in the air. So thereby, motionless tree, if you observe a motionless tree, still tree, you cannot have the, you cannot study the meditation. You have to watch a moving tree in the air. And if you slowly, if you silently watch the moving tree or in a moving sea, so some water, the waves, and you observe some motion, then only you travel along with the motion. You travel along with the swinging of the tree. So then only you can equip yourself. After equipping yourself to attending the tree like this, some motion of the tree, some motion of the waves, then only you can, you yourself can feel you are moving along with that. So that you have to practice. This is the first step. After practicing and successful of this practice alone, it will be very easy to apply the same thing in all the circumstances.
On people.
Okay.
So you can practice it on the people.
People.
Where you want to get connected with the people.
Yeah, yeah.
So you can use this meditation and get connected with them.
Connected with them.
So to understand or to convey what we think or something.
Not conveying, yes. But being one with the person. So it is a meditation. You are one with the person. You become the other person. Then you find some oneness between yourself and the other person. The other person may be your enemy.
Okay.
But at the same time, whenever you are in the meditation, you become one with the other person. And there is some communion with yourself.
And the other object should be with life. Right? If suppose tree or waves, they have motion, has got life.
Life.
But we cannot use a pendulum or something like that?
It may also like that. For some, for example, the fan, you can observe
slow
a fan,
speed.
Moving fan.
That's also possible.
No, that also a work. Slow speed. So high speed, if it it will
follow,
it not concentrate.
Yes.
If it is slow speed, this speed is enough.
Okay.
Our ideas, we would immediately react, no. With this meditation, we will see, we will not fight with that quality. So either we won't fight with our own qualities, or we won't fight with the other. Even some dog may create a sound. You may feel, I'm disturbed, my sleep is disturbed. But with this meditation, you will become one with the sound. And you won't be feeling that the dog is making noise and you are disturbed. Because you are connected, then you can peacefully be with that situation. So it is to accept ourselves fully as well as the external things or people fully.
Here, the problem is that you are not giving importance to the eye consciousness. That is the important. That is the problem. If you give importance to the eye consciousness, this sleepy state will not happen. This is a kind of sleepy state, but this sleepy state will not happen if you give importance to the eye consciousness. Because that is why I am giving importance to the eye consciousness in many ways. You have to take the eye consciousness as the absolute God itself. You have to take all respect to the eye consciousness, then only you will be attentive. For example, whenever we are sitting here, somebody goes there and somebody goes there, we don't give importance to, we are concentrated upon the meeting. You will not be aware of the other persons coming and going. But at the same time, if the Prime Minister of India coming here, you simply neglect the meeting. Your attention will goes there. So why? Because you are giving importance to the particular thing. So in this way, you have to give importance to the eye consciousness. So whenever you give importance to the eye consciousness as the absolute reality or somewhere, so whatever is the highest thing, you have to put it everything upon the eye consciousness. Then only the eye consciousness will be powerful and attractive. So you make it attractive. Then only the attraction will be there. Otherwise, you'll be in the distraction. If in the sleepy state, is always a kind of distraction. But if you are attracted by the eye consciousness, there's even though you are sleepy, sleep will go away from you, and some attention will be there. Then only the vibration will be there. Otherwise, it will not create vibration. 12th. Now we are going to see what is Mano Laya and Mano Nasa. Mano Laya means we have already seen something. The mind has to take shape. The taking shape by the mind is known as Mano Laya. Whenever we understand something, that is Mano Laya. For example, I look at a tree. If I want to recognize it is a tree, our mind must take the shape of the shape of the tree itself. Then only I can understand, I can recognize it is a tree. So the mind is taking a shape. For example, I have the feeling of anger, fear, happiness, peace of mind, everything, whatever it may be. If I feel something, that is Mano Laya. So I have some idea. This idea is Mano Laya. Without manolaya, we cannot have any idea. Without our thought, we are having thought. The thought is a kind of manolaya. Our emotion, it is a kind of manolaya. So whatever we are having, the mind is taking a shape for that. So taking a shape, it is manolaya. Now we are taking a sleep, whether it is a manolaya or not. It is also a manolaya. The sleep is the state of sleep is a manolaya. It is a shape. It is a shape of a mind. So we are doing meditation. The meditation is a kind of manolaya. The experience of meditation is also a manolaya. Samadhi state, there is nothing, we do not know anything, it is also a kind of manolaya. So whatever may be the experience, whatever may be the form, the mind is taking a shape for that. So that is manolaya. And what is manonasa? Manonasa means the dissolution of the shape. If you are free from the shape, that is manonasa. Strictly speaking, manolayanasa, the dissolution from the shape. Not manonasa, manolayanasa is the appropriate word. But if the each and every moment our mind taking a shape, the next moment it is free from the shape. If we are already free from the shape, we cannot take a new shape. So whenever we want to take a new shape, the old shape has to go. So each and every moment, the mind taking a shape, the next moment is free from the shape. Now, we are having a problem. Is it a manolaya or manonasa? Manolaya. So the manolaya alone, that we can feel. So enlightenment, we are saying something about enlightenment. Whether the enlightenment is manolaya or manonasa. So we understand something. All understanding is manolaya. With the help of manolaya alone, we can understand something. When we are saying something about liberation, what is liberation, whether it is manolaya or manonasa? Liberation alone is manonasa. So liberation and manonasa is same. So we are free from the shape. Freedom from the shape is manonasa, manolaya nasa, and it is liberation. Liberation and manonasa is same. So here also, but the important thing, but the manolaya nasa is a natural state. We need not create it. It is natural. Because whatever comes, it loses its shape. So the losing its shape is the natural state. For example, we are writing our name upon the water. The name cannot stay there forever. For the time being, whenever you write, the letters will be there. The next moment it will go. The shapeless state of the water is the natural state. So in this way, the manolaya nasa is our natural state. Whatever comes, it takes a form. The next moment it is free from the form. The free from the form is our natural state. So taking a shape is an artificial state. It's a temporary one. But even though it is a temporary one, we are doing everything only with the help of the manolaya alone. Even the enlightenment itself is possible with the help of manolaya. So we cannot underestimate manolaya. Manolaya is a good one. But the problem is that we should not caught within the manolaya. When the manolaya take a well or anything, it creates a circle within itself, then only it creates a problem. For example, whenever we are having some sorrow, fear or anger, when we are caught in that emotion and we are unable to free from the emotion, then only the manolaya becomes a problem. So there are several problems. But if it is, even though it is a world or anything, even it is circling it itself, each and every moment it is a new, but it is circling around itself, then only it creates a strength. When it creates a circle, when it is creating a world around itself, then it creates a strength about itself, then only it becomes a problem. So, for example, when we are having a river like this, it is flowing regularly, even though it has a flow, it will not create a more strength like a world. So if the water is circling itself just like a world, then it creates a strength and it suffocates ourselves. So in this way, whatever may be the emotion, whatever may be the situation, if it is freely comes and goes, there is no problem. But at the same time, the understanding also comes, our intellect also comes, our understanding, everything comes only with the help of the manolaya. We have to know something, and with the help of knowing something, we can understand something. We can establish a understanding with the help of manolaya alone. If there is no manolaya, understanding is also not possible. So, but we can make use of the manolaya. Each and every work, I mean, manolaya alone, all work is possible. Because we are doing our duty, we are going to our office, we are going to deal with our daily business, everything with the help of manolaya alone. If there is no manolaya, if manolaya is not possible, we cannot attend any of our work. So everything is good, manolaya is also good. But when it becomes stable and it is unable to go away, then only the problem starts. So the manolaya comes and goes, that is a healthy state of our mind. So in this way, each and every moment it has to take a shape, and in the next moment it must be free from the shape. So then only it is a healthy state. So even though we are giving name in the name of manolaya or manonasa, thereby we can understand the real nature is must be in a flexible manner. Whatever comes, that has to go away, and this manolaya nasa is considered as the liberated state. And but with the help of the manolaya nasa, we cannot do anything. It is only an action that we have freedom. It is in a healthy state, but we cannot do anything with the help of manolaya nasa. But itself, it is a healthy state. To maintain ourselves in a healthy state, the manolaya nasa is necessary. But we cannot use manolaya nasa for all our work. So liberation cannot be useful for any of our day-to-day life. Only manolaya alone, with the formation of our mind, with the help of our mind alone, we can do something in our day-to-day life and everything. Even enlightenment itself is possible only with the help of manolaya. So manolaya is a practical one. And at the same time, the manolaya nasa must be there. It is a natural state. It has no connection for ourselves. We have no duty with related to the manolaya nasa, and it is a natural state, and we should keep ourselves not disturbing the manolaya nasa. We can make use of manolaya, but at the same time we have to keep ourselves not disturbing the natural state, and we have to allow the mind to go to its natural state after the purpose is over. Manolaya has to come, and it has to give way to the manolaya nasa. It has to give way to the natural state of our mind. And this clarification we have to understand. And if you feel any question with related to manolaya and mananasa, we can ask.
So an example of manolaya would be, it could be a thought that has come in my head, and manonasa that it, I have an understanding that I have no work to do. Hmm. Is that right?
So your understanding is also manolaya.
Yes.
And because of your understanding, you may find no work.
Yes.
But what no work towards what?
Towards, for example, if it's a worry thought, I don't like go on in that worry, or I don't get stuck in that thought.
So no work towards the manolaya nasa. So towards the liberation and manolaya nasa, we have no work. So our work is only to the manolaya itself. We have no work towards the manonasa or the liberation. Liberation is natural, manolaya nasa is also natural. For that you have no work, because that is the highest state. And in the spiritual world, the highest state is not enlightenment. The highest state is liberation. The highest state is manolaya nasa. And for that you have no work. If you have any work, it is towards only manolaya alone. Our work is limited to manolaya alone.
So what is the concern towards manonasa? How do I relate to it?
So it is a natural state. We have to recognize. So manolaya nasa is also there.
Okay.
So you have to recognize.
Okay.
The recognition is also on the part of the manolaya itself. Only the manolaya alone recognize the manonasa.
So you said samadhi is also a state of manolaya. Doesn't samadhi means liberation? Like liberation is a state of manolaya nasa. So doesn't samadhi equivalent to
and samadhi has no connection with liberation. It is a state. Samadhi is a state. Meditation is a state. Everything is a state. If it is a state, it is manolaya. But because manolaya nasa is not at all a state. All states are in the flowing nature. When comes and goes, that is known as manonasa. So it is a flowing one. What is flowing? The manolaya is flowing.
Samadhi doesn't mean like liberation will happen.
Samadhi?
In samadhi, liberation will not happen, right?
It has no connection with liberation.
No connection.
Samadhi is a state. You can have an experience. All experiences are manolaya. But don't underestimate manolaya. Manolaya is also good state, even good state also manolaya, bad state also manolaya. Everything is manolaya. There is clarification, there is some grade, good state. Even good state is manolaya. Even enlightenment is manolaya. Everything is manolaya. But the dissolution of everything is manonasa. That is the liberation. There should not be any state. All state must be in the liquid form. Memory is a dormant state. We cannot feel your memory. Whenever it comes as a thought, then only you can feel something related to memory. Because memory is a state. Thought alone you can feel. We cannot feel the memory. But the thought comes from memory. But memory, when the thought is a manolaya, and the thought comes and goes. When the thought comes, it is manolaya. When the thought moving or disappearing, it is manonasa.
Even after the nasa,
memory is there. Memory we cannot feel. Whatever you feel it is through your thought. So thought is manolaya. You cannot feel memory.
Memory directly we cannot
feel.
This terminology, manolaya and manonasa, I had first read in Ramana Maharshi even before coming here. But is this Manolaya and in Patanjali Yoga Sutra text true? Is Nirvikalpa Samadhi the equivalent of Manonasha or it is something else?
No, no. Manonasa, Manonasa means actually Manam Buddhi Siddha Mahangaram in this case, the Manam is a 1/4 of the total mind. So in that sense, we can use it as a Manonasa. But otherwise, Manolaya Nasa is the appropriate word.
Equivalent word to this before that in any text is there or this is a created word by this word is created by Ramana Maharshi or it was there even before that Manolaya Manonasa and all that.
So Manolaya Nasa Manonasa is the technical word of the scriptures, and we are also using that word, but strictly speaking, even you may free from the word itself because the content is that the mind has to take shape. And afterwards, it has to be free from the shape. That is the main thing. We have to understand. The mind has to take shape. The taking shape, we can use the word Manolaya. If not necessary, you can without the word, you can understand. The mind whether the mind has take shape, taking shape, we are naming it as Manolaya, and free from the shape.
Or
is
total destruction also. Total destruction of that mind.
After the mind?
See, there is Manolaya. Everything that we are in is Manolaya. Even our speaking, thoughts,
everything
is Manolaya.
Oh.
So the destruction of this state is Manonasa or
the
that original state is Manonasa?
No, the Manonasa is not at all a state. The disappearance of the Manolaya can be considered as the it is only an disappearance.
Disappearance of all the states that we know, that is Manonasa.
Not all the state. Whatever may be the state goes away. So the going away of the state, each and every each and every Manolaya Nasa.
So that means Manonasa can never be an attainment.
No, it cannot be an attainment.
Yes. It is just the passing away of all the shows.
It is not an attainment. But anyhow, but indirectly you can take it as an attainment because this is a greatest thing, because the liberation is considered as the greatest thing in the spiritual world, and in the real world also this kind of action of the mind can be considered as the great, but in itself is not at all a state because it is not a fixed one.
Or it can be said it is unattainable also in a way, because whatever we are trying, we can't get this.
But in one sense it is attainable, in another sense it is unattainable. Both can be, you can use, because it is not at all a state. If it is a state, then we can attain. But at the same time, we can refer it is a state.
Something which has to come on its own rather.
Because it is a natural state. Because we are also we are also using a word. It is a natural state. That means it is a function of the thing.
So the natural state or the original state?
Original state.
It's already attained.
No, already there. For example, only because it is a state, but it is unaware of itself. But at the same some because of our Manolaya, some disturbance happens. Afterwards, the disturbance goes. So the original exists as it is. Without the thought, we cannot feel memory.
We cannot relate with memory.
And relate with memory, we cannot feel. So thought means we are feeling the memory. But at the same, if there is no thought, there is no memory. Memory is there. But when there is no thought, there is no memory.
But when your thought is lost, it doesn't mean the loss of memory. Am I correct?
Whenever you are in the deep sleep without any thought, even then memory is there, but you cannot aware of that.
Only when thought arises, we relate with memory.
We relate with that.
Memory is the dormant state of thought.
Thought.
May I take like that?
Okay.
Memory is the dormant state of thought.
Thought and experiences, everything.
Thought and experience. Thought activates the memory.
Memory.
Relate by.
Okay.
Yesterday you mentioned about awareness and consciousness. So consciousness, you said like is it includes both body consciousness and mind consciousness.
Hmm.
And then there is one awareness at mind level, and then there is this awareness you mentioned which is separate than consciousness. So what is that awareness? Can you talk a little more about that awareness, which
so
is different from the...
Awareness is the basic structure that we cannot feel, we cannot aware of that. The awareness alone can aware of it. And what we aware, what we can feel is only the consciousness. The all consciousness is the expression of awareness. Without awareness, no consciousness. So the consciousness means, for example, we are having some sensitivity. The sensitivity we cannot feel. But when we touch here, the touch feeling we can feel. So whatever we can feel is the... Basically, it comes from the original sensitivity. The original sensitivity you cannot feel. The original sensitivity can be known as the awareness. But what we, that we cannot feel. What we feel is only the expression of the basic awareness. The basically, the absolute thing is awareness. And that is Atma, that is Brahman. Everything is the awareness that we cannot feel.
Manole Nasha. Awareness is manolayanasa.
Manolayana, awareness is not manolayanasa. Awareness is that we cannot feel. But we can feel the, whatever we feel is the manolaya. And the dissolution of the manolaya also we can feel. That is, it is in the level of consciousness. The manolaya and manolayanasa comes in the level of consciousness. In the awareness level we cannot feel. We cannot know anything. Awareness we cannot feel. For example, some water is there. In the water, you are writing your name. Afterwards, the writing goes away. So the writing comes and goes. That is the manolaya and manonasa. You are not taking anything. We are not speaking anything about the water. Only the appearance and disappearance of the word alone we are speaking. That is purely consciousness. We are not speaking anything about awareness. But everything happens within the awareness, but we are not referring anything about the awareness. We are only speaking about the word letter and the disappearance of the letter. Appearance and disappearance alone we are speaking. The appearance is known as manolaya, the disappearance is known as manolaya nasa. But when the water is, when the letter is there, whether the water has disappeared, but water is always there. Whether the water, whether in the letter is there, whether the letter is not there, the water is always there. We are not speaking about that. Only the letter alone appears and disappears. The appearance of letter is manolaya. The disappearance of the letters is manolaya nasa. And now we can go.